Good evening, and welcome to the Solutions to the Problem Sets. I'm Kevin Ahern, and I'm going to be leading you through these, as we will see. Some of the problems are more of the nature of thought problems, about which I will do very little writing and more talking. Other problems that I will work in these sets will be more along the lines of problems, and you'll see me working them on the screen here. I will post appropriately all of the images that you'll see here on the web. So stay tuned for that. So the first problem set number one, and for those who are viewing this from the Biochemistry Free-for-All book and not part of my class at Oregon State, we are using that book in BB 450 at Oregon State University. So that's why you see problem set one labeled as DB 451. The answers are, however, to the problems posted for Biochemistry Free and Easy. So getting right into it, I have posed a series of sort of thought problems as an introduction to the subject. And we can see these in the very first one. One was to describe how technological advances ultimately destroyed vitalism and gave rise to the understanding we have of life today. And I talked about that in the lecture that is linked on the video in Biochemistry Free for All, but I will repeat that a little bit here. It was an important thing for scientists to overcome, to get past the idea that there was something magical that was happening inside of cells. And we can talk about magic happening in a figurative sense. But in a literal sense, everything that happens inside of a cell obeys the laws of the universe. So vitalism really was this idea that there was something magical and that cells didn't obey those laws of the universe. And there were several things that overcame that. The biggest one that I noted in class was the synthesis by Friedrich Wöhler of urea. Prior to that time, no one had synthesized in a test tube the compound urea, which was known to be produced only biologically at that time. And so the synthesis of urea helped to convince people that the cell, in fact, was a part of the universe. Other things that came along the way that helped people to better understand that cells really were interesting things were, of course, the invention of the microscope to begin with. The microscope, for the first time, allowed us to see that fundamental biological unit, which was the individual cell. And our understanding of life and what happens inside of cells ultimately sprang from all of that. Today, of course, we know that below the level of the cell, molecules ultimately govern what happens in biology. The second question had to do with describing living systems starting from a perspective of an ecosystem and working down ultimately to DNA, RNA, and enzymes. And this is an exercise I like for my students to think about. If we think about, for example, at the level of an ecosystem, we can think of a forest, we can think of an ocean, we can think of a system that's comprised of many individual units. Those individual units, of course, being organisms, being bacteria, being a variety of things that are there. If we had no technology and we were examining the world from the perspective of an ecosystem, we could say that an ecosystem really is something that is like a living thing. A forest responds to the environment. A forest has a growth. A forest has turnover, and all of these things like a living system does. Well, ecosystems, of course, are comprised of many organisms, and individual organisms within an ecosystem would be our next level of thinking of life. A forest has trees, a forest has animals, a forest has grasses, has other plants, and it also, for that matter, has unicellular organisms as well. But from a macroscopic world, we could think of the ecosystem as being comprised of organisms, individual organisms. And what the idea of all this is that I'm trying to get us to think about, well, what really is life? Is an ecosystem life? Is an organism life? What really is the unit that we think of and define as life? If we look at an organism and we dissect that organism, we see that the organism, if it's an animal, for example, is comprised of tissues. And those tissues include bones and muscle and skin and intestines and various other organs. And if we were to look at those organs, we could say that the organism is a function of or the sum of all of those individual tissues. And we would be getting closer to understanding what life really was. But I don't think anyone would argue that tissues are fundamental units of life or fundamental influencers of life. The individual tissues, of course, are comprised of cells. And again, it was the invention of the microscope that allowed us to understand this basic building block of an organism. Prior to the invention of the microscope, that wasn't possible. And so we could imagine a lot of images or visions that people had of what a living system actually was. And it's not surprising then that a living system might have seemed magical. The idea that organisms or that cells were in fact fundamental units of life was a very important understanding in the overall basis of life. And with the invention of the microscope, we saw that there were in fact unicellular organisms like bacteria that existed in the world that nobody had idea even existed prior to that point. Well, if we take a cell and we think about a cell as being the basic unit of life, we still are left with the question about how does a cell function? It's the problem of the atomic scientist who looks for smaller and smaller fundamental particles comprising the matter that we see all around us. And the answer to the question of what it was that made a cell what it was really began to come in about the 1930s, when people began to rethink the idea that the cell was really the basis of everything. Biologically, the cell is, in fact, the basis of all that we know as life. But within cells, cells have to be controlled by something, and those cells are controlled by molecules. And the idea that molecular biology began to take hold in the 30s really was a very important thing for us to understand about our view of life today. We know, of course, that cells are a function of the nucleic acids that they contain, DNA and RNA, DNA, of course, making RNA and RNA coding for protein. We know that the proteins are the workhorses of the cell. We know of metabolic pathways. We know of individual reactions that are happening inside of cells. And we also know that everything that a cell is based on molecules. The idea of molecular biology was, in fact, a valid one and was one that is fundamental to our understanding about how life on Earth exists. The third question asks, from the perspective of our understanding of life, why are Darwin's and Mendel's observations so critical? Well, I'll start with Mendel, actually. Mendel was the first person who really got it as far as transmission, inheritance of traits, transmission of traits and inheritance actually occurred in his work with peas. By recognizing that the present day organism that's here, this pea plant, is a function and is related to the pea plant that gave rise to it, wasn't a completely surprising idea. Pea plants only give rise to other pea plants. But when you looked closer and you looked at individual traits, whether the pod of the pea was shriveled or colored or whatever, that one could actually determine the basis by which those traits were actually transmitted. And Mendel, we owe a great deal to for that. His work, of course, was lost for many years before it was rediscovered, and his genius was rediscovered. Darwin, we tend to think of as the person who identified and recognized that evolution was a critical thing for understanding life on Earth. And there's no question that that was the case. But a corollary to Darwin's observation was that all life on Earth ultimately came from a single cell. And that's a remarkable thing for us to think about. It means that all life on Earth, whether it's human beings or it's turnips or it's goats or it's bacteria, all ultimately trace their roots back to the same system. And we have very, very good evidence of that, of course, based on the fact that we all share the same genetic code. We all share many, many metabolic pathways. Cells are much more alike than they are different when we look at them at the molecular level. And that idea that we all are related and that individual organisms didn't just spring up out of the blue, but rather could be traced back evolutionarily, is the debt that we owe to Darwin. Erwin Schrödinger can be thought of as a founder of sorts of our current view of living systems, and explain why. And the answer to that question is largely the answer I gave to the end of the second question. And that is that Erwin Schrödinger, in his book, What is Life, in the 1930s, first got people thinking about what it was that was below the cellular level that was, in fact, what caused cells to be what they were. We still argue the question, what is life? What is the meaning of life? We know what it takes for a cell to be alive. We may not understand all of the intricacies of biochemistry occurring within a cell, but we do know that the basis of that life of a living cell is rooted in molecules, and Erwin Schrödinger deserves recognition for that.